Ryan Murphy. On the forums, you might know me as Ektar, one of the English community managers. Today we're going to do a Q&A session, roughly about an hour's time, and then we'll head over to the Spring Air Museum, where they have sandwiches and drinks for the people who have signed up for the first 100. And if you're not part of the first 100 sign-ups, I do apologise, and we only had a limited pool that we could cover from, but I do believe you can still get refreshments there, or you can still like get refreshments downstairs as well. I'm able to answer a lot of questions today about the future of our games, or any questions you have about the games existing. I need to pre-warn you, I don't know necessarily a lot about Clan Wars. Our Clan Wars specialist wasn't able to speak to before coming here. Regarding all our other games, we recently had Tankfest in Bovington, England, and I was able to speak to our product specialists and producers before then. So I've been briefed about some future stuff and what I can and can't comment on. Another thing to point out is we have GamesCon very soon in Germany, so there's some stuff that I can't talk about because it's going to be talked about at GamesCon or revealed at GamesCon. And basically, just if you have any questions, put up your hand, we'll try to get through as many as I can as possible. So, fire away. Yes?
When are you introducing the Havoc engine?
That's a good question. It's been actively worked on just now, and we've seen video demos of it before already, of the different versions of it and different states of it. Just now it's mainly a performance issue system. They want to add it in game without drastically affecting the performance. So it's still planned, but as to giving a date, it's not possible to say when. It's one of the biggest dangers of games development to say this is coming at this time frame, because so much stuff is subject to change, and when you don't deliver, players always assume that as being set in stone concrete. And the devs kind of made that mistake already with Tanks, because we said we're going to do it by a certain patch number, and we've not been able to do it. So it's still being actively worked on by a team, and once they've been able to get it so that it won't affect performance as it does just now, then it's something they'll look to add in as soon as they can. But for when, that's sadly not something we have an actual time to quote.
What exactly is it going to change in the game?
From what I understand, the biggest thing is just basically environmental changes. So things like destructible buildings. It's going to work at certain levels, and the rubble's not always going to stay there as well, because that's another performance issue. So like if you knock down a building and the building broke into pieces, eventually the pieces would go away. They're not all going to stay there, and not going to have everything like drive about as an individual thing that has to be remapped or reconsidered every time someone collides with it. But basically, so it's environmental stuff to make the environment look more pretty and more fancy. And I think when they do that as well, they plan to change the vehicle handling characteristics slightly as well. But again, all this kind of stuff's not set in stone until they decide when and how, basically.
But that's going to be implemented as well from all the vehicles.
The way vehicle handling changes slightly, I believe so as well, because they want to be able to put tanks on the roof and stuff like that. So yeah. Mm-hmm. Well. Any other questions? Guys, I'm supposed to question, sure. Yes?
Are there going to be bad weather in World of Warships?
Weather effects is something that's been actively worked on as well. Again, weather is similar to the Havoc engine, it's a performance thing. More so on warships, because you have a million and one raindrops hitting into the water, so you have to have the the animation of the actual rain hitting the water.
Yeah.
With our Xbox version, not for World of Warships, for World of Tanks, they added in weather effects, because with the Xbox console, one person's Xbox console and configuration is the same as the next person's console and configuration. So the developers can really push out the features on Xbox, and they can really push the limits, because they know what they have in their office is the exact same as what the person at home has. With World of Tanks, you have the limitation of they can push these like really high-end developer PCs to put out amazing graphics, but then 50% of our player base can't play it because the computer doesn't have the processing power or the graphics card. So they're trying to do something like weather effects that's not going to basically impact on performance, because, I mean, you're talking about something like maybe 70 to 60% of the player base is in the Russian region, and their computer specs aren't necessarily as high as somebody from the American region or Western Europe, where incomes, for example, are much higher and people can afford higher spec PCs. So it's always an awkward balance, but especially for warships, because of the size of the maps that we have and because of just simply the added atmosphere of adding in weather effects, it was something that was asked a lot in beta and pushed for a lot in beta, And if you actually look at the edges of some of the maps, you can actually see weather effects already. So it's something they're looking to add in. I don't know necessarily if it will come with like stormy season stuff. That was always something else that we talked about that could be done. Like you could have a map where you make it, it's much harder to shoot somebody because you're at the trough of a wave and they're at a peak of a wave. But then you don't want it to make it so that the game is like incredibly difficult to actually hit somebody because you're spending the whole time moving and half the players are getting sick because of motion sickness. It's one of the reasons, for example, that Warplanes isn't doing well. Warplanes has got its own different ways why it's not successful, but one of the things of Warplanes is it's never done too great when we try to make it competitive. Because when you're watching somebody else playing, you're not in control, it's very easy to get motion sickness as the plane's swaying about. So that was something they're keen to try and avoid on warships, is to make people, you know, get queasy.
Yeah, okay.
Yes?
I have a question about the torpedoes in warships.
Okay.
It's about the extreme angles.
Okay.
Where they impact.
Yeah.
At the moment I'm running around in the pesky little destroyers, and quite a lot of times I get hit by, you know, from extreme angles,
mm-hmm.
Minus one, plus 1 degrees right in the front, and it gets a little bit frustrating to get wrecked every single time by torpedoes that are not, you know, acoustic or depth set.
Yeah.
They should simply just bounce off the side, not even scratch my paint.
Yeah.
So, is that something that you're willing to look
It's something
into?
That's, actually we just talked about it recently, because I'm a huge warspite player, and my main ships are destroyers and battleships. So I get really defensive when talking about torpedoes, because I hate them and love them. And only recently I was joking about saying, how fun would it be if you could like angle a torpedo, if you could get a torpedo coming at you and you could deflect it, and then the guy beside me straight away says, imagine you getting taken out because the guy beside you deflected a torpedo into you, you know? It happens in World of Tanks, because they have that mechanic in World of Tanks, and you can see some amazing, almost snooker-like shots of people getting killed by a ricochet. I don't think it's something they're looking at initially just now for torpedoes, because they don't want to overcomplicate the game at the start. And the torpedo mechanics are fairly simple. If the torpedo hits you, it's going to do damage. If it's angled, it will do less damage though than if you take it flush. If you take a torpedo like flush in the side, it's going to hurt like heck.
Yeah.
If you take it more of an angled side, especially if, for example, you're on a battleship that has the bulges, the damage is reduced, and sometimes the damage is actually quite negligible compared to taking it full on flush, because that's where the torpedo does its most impact. But because they don't have the different torpedo arming types like you were talking about, that's why they don't have that mechanic of, Is it a dud, you know, or does it bounce off? Because again, that's something I sometimes get a bit salty about carrier torpedoes. And I'm like, why don't we have the potential for duds? Because there were so many of these carrier torpedoes that would hit the water and not activate, or they would activate with the spin, but they wouldn't detonate. Why is there no option in game for torpedoes to have the potential to miss? You know, if you shoot your shells across, if you aimed at somebody, and you know you've got his measure. He's not changed his speed since your previous salvo, your aim's held true, you've still got the spread of your shots, not every shot hits in. But if you do that with torpedoes, then all torpedoes will always hit. And I think it's because they want the torpedoes to be the skill shot. So if you have aimed your torpedoes and you've aimed them well, then you're rewarded with all your torpedoes hitting home, and you're not rewarded with one out of five being the live one and five duds, you know?
No, so, I'm not talking about dodge, you know, like that.
Oh yeah, I mean, but like the potential of the different damage. Yeah, it's more of a, they don't have different arming mechanics, so I think that's, they just want to make it, if the torpedo hits you, it's going to damage you.
It's just that, you know, you made your perfect maneuver to get out of the harm's way of the torps, and then you actually sit and tighten your butt.
Yeah.
Actually,
yeah.
Like that.
You
still get wrecked.
Yeah.
I mean,
but you get those ones as well where you're almost certain it's going to hit you, and it goes past the, you know, it goes past the butt end of your ship,
yeah,
and you're like, or the ship turns round and it's the wake of the ship, you're like, try to cancel order back in, yeah. So I mean that play, like to me the destroyer gameplay of doing that and dodging torpedoes is always good fun. Not so much in a battleship, but you can still pull off some nice manoeuvres in battleships. But yeah, it could potentially be something to change that. I mean, it's another one of these things. What I said in the first group as well is one of the biggest challenges we have with World of Warships right now is it's just launched into open beta. When we were in closed beta testing, I think the servers were capped at, I think maybe 5,000, 6,000 was the peak in closed beta. And when we had the test servers in closed beta when we were about to roll out a new patch, those test servers were capped at 2,500. Now, before I came here, Warships was peaking at 46,000 on Europe alone. Europe's actually leading the Warship player base right now. We have the biggest concentration of players in Europe right now. So we're beating Russia's numbers, we're beating America, we're beating Asia. And Warships has started to have its own player base separate from World of Tanks. And Europe's the ones that are really big for that. So as time goes on and we get the weeks go by, we'll be able to then pull stats from the game. Because just now, we're almost having a bit of trouble keeping up with the information because there's so many players playing and so many battles happening. This like system we used to have to gather stats is like, whoa, too many players, whoa! So once that's kind of stabled out a bit and there's a bit more spread through the tiers, then we'll be able to say like, well, maybe torpedoes are too powerful, or maybe it's not a good idea, like for example, it's not a good idea to have carriers at the top of the tree because they don't have any hard counters until the battle develops or something like that. And so all this is still being looked at, and it's easily, especially with Warships, it has a high potential to still potentially be changed because it's still in beta testing just now. Something I forgot to say at the start as well, sorry, obviously I'm Scottish. sometimes when I get a bit nervous, which is kind of rare usually, I might talk too quickly or mumble. If that happens, just please let me know. I try to talk as clear as possible, and I try to slow down my voice and accent as much as possible. But normally I talk really quickly.
That's okay.
Yes.
Yes. Again, World Warships.
Yes.
What national trees are you planning to implement next?
Good question. This was just asked in our previous session as well. So we have the American and Japanese lines already, with four branches on each of them. So we have battleship, cruiser, destroyer, aircraft carrier. We're looking to add in next the Soviet ships as well, the German ships, Kriegsmarine, and the Royal Navy. The timeline for these ships is not 100% set in stone, it's still interchangeable, and a lot of the assets of the stuff is being developed alongside each other. So as far as I understand, the German and Russian ships are being developed side by side, with the Royal Navy coming fifth. And a lot of people might get up in arms about, oh, why is the Royal Navy fifth? They were the biggest navy. Like, it doesn't matter that they were the biggest navy. Like, we can only add so many ships in the game at so much time. And I know that a lot of people think that we shouldn't add Russian ships because they didn't really have much of a navy in World War II, and it was paper ships and stuff. But we can't ignore the fact that 60 to 70% of Wargaming.net existing player base is Russian already, and they already have accounts. So it makes, you're an idiot in business sense if you don't already cater or tap into an existing market to try and get them interested in a new thing. So it's not that we're ignoring the Royal Navy. We know the Royal Navy has a huge potential of ships, huge historical value. And you have people like me always saying every day, where's the Scotland flags? Why don't we have Scotland flags again? British ships never flew Scotland flags, but I still message them every day and make fun of the Scotland flags. And that's part of the reason, if you saw with the new signal flag system, if you look at the examples of signal flags, they always have the one that looks like a sub tire. And that's partly because of me always pestering them. So it's a little nod to me to say, like, look, there's your bloody Scotland flag. And I do the same with World of Tanks every day, like, do you have any feedback for new game features? And, you know, everyone's like, oh, matchmaking, rebalance artillery. I'm like, where's the Scotland flags for the emblems? You know, but yeah, so going back to the original topic, sorry. So American and Japanese are already in game. German and Soviet developing side by side. I'm not necessarily sure which will come in first. I think the plan was Soviet. It could potentially change, and then you might see German ships first, because if the European player base is the core player base and it's bigger, then hopefully that's more voice, if you like, to say, like, hey, like, you know, give these players something that might be more interesting to them. Royal Navy next. Other two navies that they've looked at for potential new nations are the French Navy and the Italian Navy. And then outside of those seven nations, I'm not sure what else they would add. We joke in office all the time, the Czechoslovakian Navy, the Czech Republic. Czech Republic's a landlocked country, you know. So.
it should be easy to implement.
Yeah, once we kept, I was always pushing to say we should have an April Fool's thing, and this tier one is man of war ships just going around in circles, like full broadside each other. Or tier one should be a robot, and you work up from that. Yes.
Also regarding the different types of ships, I actually have a question regarding the age of some of them, because some of the ships, like the St. Louis and the Chester, early ships, they had, they're from, 1910, 1908, something like that.
Yeah.
But regarding the Russian Navy, and in particular the German Navy, they had some really big, important ships, but from the First World War.
Yeah.
And especially the Russian Navy was more or less destroyed during the Revolution. So,
yeah.
So how would you compensate for that? Because there can only be so many blueprints.
Yeah.
I know there are some quite big Russian battleships.
And in those situations, it's similar to how they've done it in World of Tanks. They look at what the designs were and what they would theoretically be if they carried on with that design structure. Like for tanks in Germany, it was really hard to balance, because up to a certain point, Germany just didn't make any more tanks.
Yeah.
So we have to do something to add in to fill those gaps. Like the Mouse makes sense at tier 10, but then other tank nations continue developing their tanks, so they switched over to MBT, so tanks generally changed, whereas Germany was stopped at a certain level and then there was nothing past that. With the Soviet stuff, from what I understand, there's a lot of special warships, there's a lot of stuff designed but they couldn't make because of the treaties. That some of them said, like, this is a treaty, like, and everyone's like, okay, and then somebody else would go, actually, I'm just going to build this, and then later on come out of the treaty, and hey, I've got this ship that, like, you don't care about, or it doesn't matter, like, screw your treaty, I want bigger guns. So there's a lot of stuff that was written down and planned for, but they couldn't build because of the treaties, and they have very detailed designs of those ships, and the plans for those ships. When it comes to, like, bigger ships that would be older, but obviously can't be in a tier 1 or tier 2, they could always put them in at maybe like a tier 5 or tier 6 premium or something like that. And the historical configuration might be just adjusted so that it makes more of a balance in game. Because we can't have, like, for example, we can't have the guns shoot the full range that the guns would shoot, because you'd be shooting across the map the entire time. So they'd have to adjust the gun ranges, and that's something that's used as a balancing parameter in ships just now. Turret rotation and gun accuracy as well is something that they use as a balance mechanic as well, and obviously the speed of the ships and then the turn radius of the ships.
Yeah.
So if there is older ships that wouldn't fit in the tree, because you know you're not going to have a tier 1 battleship or something like that, then you would add that in later on as maybe a tier 3 unlockable or something like that.
Do you know the size of the Danish player base?
I don't know, stand up everyone. You're a sizable player base. I mean, we wouldn't be here if it wasn't a big enough player base. I think last server stats. I mean, usually when I plan events, I ask for two numbers. I ask for portal visits, so how many like hits on the portal, which country people's coming from, and game logins. So I want to see where everyone in Europe is logging in from, so I can take a rough guess. In Europe, you're definitely within probably. Last guess, probably top 18. I mean, you have our big seven languages at the start, so you have a huge English player base, English in our Europe and our UK and Ireland. Next single largest player base on its own one language is Polish. Behind Polish is then German. Surprisingly, one of the next highest ones is actually Serbian, and then Romanian. They're really, really high player base groups. Then we have Turkish, Spanish, Finnish as well is really huge. There's a lot of Finnish players. Swedish as well. Portuguese not so much. Croatian's quite high as well. Like a lot of the Eastern European countries are really quite high up.
How about Lithuania?
I'm not necessarily sure where they are. It doesn't ring a bell as being one of the countries high up. From what I can remember, it was basically seven core languages, then like Eastern European countries, then Scandinavian countries basically. I can't remember remember specifically where Denmark specifically ranks.
We need to do something about that. We can't just beat
This is certainly big enough to warrant an event for us to come out and say hello to you guys and do something like this for us.
More about how about the clan sizes in World of Tanks? Are there any plans of changing the clan sizes?
I have no idea for the clan limitations. As far as I know, that's a technical limitation for how many is in a clan. And then they just expect people to make subclans. I don't know if they would ever increase the clan size. For something like an individual language section, because usually that gets asked at events, it's not that I would be against giving Danish players a Danish clan section, because we did it recently for Dutch players, because we had a high number of Dutch players visiting the forums. The problem that brings is it then fragments the conversation. So all the Danish players are more likely just to go to the Danish forum, but you're not going to have community presence in the Danish forum, and you're not going to have much of a voice outside of the Danish section. Like, all your concerns are going to be with other Danish players, and we can't have full community teams, full customer service teams, and full content teams for every country in Europe.
No, that wouldn't make sense.
We're already one of the games who already caters for most European players. Like, Blizzard has English, German, French, Italian, I think they have a real high player base for, Russian, and then that's maybe there. I think they were looking into doing Polish. And they don't have individual sections for their Scandinavian countries as well. So it's always like a really difficult situation, because you may, what I find as well is that compared to Finland and compared to Sweden, Denmark has a much higher percentage of people who speak English and speak it fluently. So again, it's a harder argument for us to put it forward to our bosses for an individual language section. It's needed, for example, for Turkish players. It's needed for possibly Romanian players, because we don't have a lot of numbers. One of the strangest things that I see recently is we have a high percentage of Italian players who visit the portal, but they don't go to the forums. So I don't understand why they're not. Is it because we don't have? Because we do have an Italian section in the forums. So that's something that's confusing. But the language things is always it's hard to cater to the different regions and keep them in. Speaking back to individual nations, there's like Danish Navy, for example, as well. People talk about the Dutch
the
Navy
robots.
As well.
Yeah.
So I don't know if it's something that sometimes if we can't have a full nation, what we might be able to do is bring in a ship, just an individual ship for that nation as a premium ship, and maybe attach it to another nation or something like that.
Omega Scandinavian tree.
I don't know if you mean like for World of Tanks.
Yeah.
I don't know if they're going to do specifically a Scandinavian tree. I know they were at Arsenal recently taking measurements, but when it comes to things like future development, they were talking about a European tree. I don't know if they're going to break off now and do an individual Swedish tree, for example, or not. That's something that hasn't even been confirmed internally. They're always looking at different vehicles and different nations and what they can add to the game. In the last session I was saying the danger was that we don't want tanks that are just a copy of another tank already. You know, we want to add it to the game, we want it to be unique or do something cool or look cool or something like that. We don't want it just to be a different sticker on the side of it that's the same vehicle. Yes?
Are you going to make a portal for starting all the war gaming games like Blizzard has?
One of the plans that's been discussed is in the way that you have battle.net that works across all Blizzard platforms. So if you log in into like StarCraft and your friends playing Warcraft, you can chat to each other. The ideas from last understanding was that we would have a similar system for our products. So you would log into World of Tanks, if your friend was playing World of Warplanes or World of Warships, you could chat using the same in-game interface.
Yeah, what I was talking about, when you start a launcher.
Okay.
Where you have all the games from
all the games at once, okay, like the Battle.net launcher.
Yes.
Yeah. Okay. I have no idea. They might plan to do something like that later on. I guess it's one of these ones where, you know, it depends on how much information people have to download all the time. And there'd be nothing worse than starting up a launcher and getting updates for all four games when you only maybe play one of them or something. I don't know if they actually have plans for that. That's certainly something I can take back and ask, are we going to do like a single launcher like Battle on it? That's one, I honestly don't know the answer to that one.
Okay.
Yeah.
Are you going to, in World of Warships, are you planning and implementing submarines?
This was asked in the last group as well. It's one of the things that's been asked about all the time. I mean, I can tell you now that if you go to the forums every week from now until this time next year, there'll be a new topic every week with somebody asking about submarines. The concept of submarines is a kind of cool idea. Historically, submarines didn't necessarily take part in fleet actions until later on in the wars. They were more used for like preying on convoy ships and stuff like that, on, individually on their own. In-game, we would need to change the game mechanics completely in the game system to support submarines. Because just now, all the ships work on one level, on the one plane. There's no variation in heights or stuff like that. So we need a different system to allow submarines to submerge and rise or go at different heights. And we'd also need to cater for submarines in a way, because the minute you surface as a submarine, the enemy's going to shoot at you. Nobody's going to want you around them, okay? You're going to be one of the most hated things on the enemy team, because nobody wants you having to deal with a hidden ship, basically. So they're going to be primary targets for everybody. You're going to have no real way to defend yourself, because you're going to have a single pop gun on the front of your ship. And when you submerge, you're going to be going 8 knots maximum, which is like less than quarter speed for most ships, even like battleships, you know? So you're going to be super slow, so pretty much all you're resigned to do is defending your cap, because you're never going to get to the enemy cap by the time the match is done. You're only going to have torpedoes that fire forward, and you're going to have a pretty short range as well. So again, it's the whole mechanic of bringing them in, and whether it would actually be a worthwhile addition to the game, fun-wise, you know, what is the actual value of adding in submarines without then having to add in like depth charges, sonar. I mean, it's bad enough having to dodge the carrier torpedo planes. Imagine having a submarine then pop up on the other side of you or something like that. So, yeah, I mean, yeah, and it would be, I mean, it would be like, it could be super powerful. If you were able to get around the other side of a warship whose guns are facing the other way, then that warship's dead in the water, because he's never going to get his guns around to shoot you, and even if he started turning, your torpedoes are already in the water. So, it's something that as a submarine player would be great fun, but playing against it would probably be pretty horrendous, and I think they're very wary of just the impact it would have on game and the amount of work it would require to put it in game and for it to be enjoyable for everybody, basically. So it's one of these things where we're not going to say no, never, because in game development that's dumb. You never say never to something, because 4 years down the line your team could implement a completely new game system structure, and it's no problem to put in submarines, and submarines are going to work perfectly. Or 3 years down the line, we've changed developers, and some guy goes, "We're adding submarines. I don't care what you guys think. We're adding submarines." And then people like us on the forums have said, "No, never, never, never." They turn around and say, "Well, actually, it's happening now." So the it's no plans now. In the future, maybe, but only because it's not considered now. Yes.
Are there any plans in World Tanks to tidy up the environment from stupid rocks, unusable bushes, and so on? Because
those things,
I
yes.
had a pretty bad experience with a freaking 183 sitting in a bush, like the front 2 meters out of the bush, and he hit me from 50 meters away. Unspotted.
For that kind of thing, yes, but it's one of these things that relies on players to report them to us, because we can't always necessarily see if something's wrong in game, and it's very easy for a team of X amount of people to miss something that a player base of 10 times the number of those people can experience and find out. The super testers usually always are tasked with finding things like this, and a lot of people think that super test is a holiday. Super test is some of the most monotonous, soul-destroying stuff that you'll ever do. It'll be like, take this tank and shoot each other for 10 minutes trying to get a fuel on fire. And these guys have to take the tank and they have to spend all evening trying to ammo rack somebody. And it happens in warships, and the warships guy's like, this is not what I thought it would be. It's like, you know, like, good luck testing the new fire mechanics guys. Because I know for the next 2 hours of the evening that these guys are going to sit and try and set each other on fire, you know, using AP shells or something. So those guys tried to find those things, and since they changed the game mechanics, where when you could, you know, you could go over the edge and stuff like that, a lot of the maps still were designed around stuff like that, so you wouldn't necessarily get stuck in a rock, because you'd just never be able to get to the rock because it was on a slope or something. So if players have these issues, report them with a screenshot and a grid reference of where they are, and then we can pass that up the chain, and then hopefully when they do the next map pass in a patch update, then that'll be removed and fixed in a patch update. Sometimes you don't know something's an issue until you drive into it, and then that's like the worst thing. For me, it's usually clipping. You don't know you can't shoot through something until you try and do it. Or
yeah.
As people with HE shells find out, when you try and shoot through a fence post and realise that you're not going to be able to shoot through it and your shell detonates as soon as it hits it. But yeah, I mean, if there's any specific things that you can think of, or that's an example, just send it in a ticket or even send me a phone PM and I can take it straight to the producer.
Okay.
Yes?
Yeah. A bit with log in there, but are you considering making it possible to be logged into more than one of your games at the same time?
I honestly don't know the answer for that again.
Yeah.
As one, yeah, the for I know recently for the test server version, people were talking about you could play one version while you were downloading another one.
Mm-hmm.
So I think that works with super for test servers now on Warships. So it used to be that you couldn't play your normal Warships while you were downloading the test server or something like that, but now it's possible. So I don't know if it's going to work so that you can be logged into both. I think the reason it's not allowed is because of the linked systems. So if you go into Warships and you go into, I know it's not linked just now, so we'll use Planes and Tanks as an example. You go into Planes and Tanks and you've got your shared gold and your shared free experience. If you say to your, you know, like somebody else in the computer beside you, go 1, 2, 3, go, and you try and spend the same gold at the same time. So I think that's the reason why they don't allow both games to be logged in at the same time, because you're using a shared resource for both games.
Ah,
that's right. But for Warships, for example, that's going to be eventually added into Warships as well. So just now it's just the game time that's shared. So if you've got your premium time in World of Tanks or World of Warplanes, if you play that game. If you've never played Warships, you play Warships now, you're automatically got premium in Warships, and it's the same premium time from your World of Tanks, World of Warships, World of Warplanes. And eventually the gold and free experience is going to be shared between both accounts as well. So that's something to be careful for, because you always get tickets saying, you know, hey, what happened to all my gold? It's like, why have you been playing World of Warplanes? It's like, no, my brother's been playing World of Warplanes. It's like, well, your brother spent your gold.
Gave him your money.
Yeah. Some more questions, yeah?
In World of Tanks, is the camouflage patterns you can apply, I'm not sure if they already have an effect or anything, but are they going to, like, in World of Warships, where you're less likely to be,
yeah,
to be seen or something?
So,
like that?
In World of Tanks, you get 5% if you have the, I think, just the premium one, you get 5% bonus to your camouflage. In Warships, Warships, and for our development teams for Warships and Xbox, they're completely separate to the World of Tanks developers. So the Xbox guys really like to push the boat out, would really like to see what they can get from their consoles and their player base and new features and stuff. Like they've added the Ripper tank, the Freedom tank, like the unique tanks in Xbox, and it works because the Xbox player is more of a younger player, American players, not so much into the historical accuracy that you might get from the PC crowd. For PC crowd and for Warships, like everyone's like, oh, where's the Razzle Dazzle camouflage? Oh, Razzle Dazzle, we want Razzle Dazzle. So Warships, they wanted to add, there's no premium shells, for example, on Warships. So thinking how, because they need some other way to monetize it, and camouflage was one of the ones they talked about. Okay, well, we'll make it so they put a camouflage on, and regardless of, they'll always get a bonus for it, so that way we can make it a one-shot, so they have to buy it, because they're getting a bonus from it. So they've got the two different methods. And initially it was going to be one camouflage, so I was even amazed that they introduced two so quickly. And they plan to add more camouflages, I think, for Warships that give different perks to make the ships a bit more tailor-made to the player. For Tanks, I don't know if that's going to happen in Tanks, because a lot of our tank developers are a bit set in their ways, so trying to get them to do things differently or change it from the way they see it is sometimes quite difficult. Additional camouflages is something, for example, I've been trying to get done as a premium shop thing. You know, like, a lot of the time we will maybe talk about something like League of Legends as a, you know, a business model. Like, Wargaming really likes how a lot of the way League of Legends is, it's like a free-to-play game. It's like the, what everyone talks about when it's esports. But a lot of their money is made from people getting up there, they're advancing to level 30 quicker to get their riot points, or by just throwing an insane amount of money on custom skins for the characters. And to me, I don't understand why we don't have custom camouflages. You know, you don't make the camouflages outrageous, you don't go for pink and like stars and stripes, but you still keep them historical. but you make it so that if you want that camouflage, you get it from the premium store, and it maybe comes with like the 5% that we already have or something like that. So it's something that could be monetized later on or added into game later on. Again, going back to the War of the Warships thing, it's one of these things where we need to wait a certain period of time on warships to see how well that's taken by the community and how much it's used before we can then turn around and say, well, look, you know, like 70% of our players are buying camouflage in warships that make it harder to shoot at them. Can you transfer that into World of Tanks mechanics? Because World of Tanks mechanics aiming is different, because you don't have an aiming circle in World of Warships. You just have the aiming time, and the dispersion of the guns is set as a specific thing. You don't have a different dispersion for the aiming time for that. So it's a slightly different mechanic, but if it's something that proves popular, then they can look to add it into warships. They're very receptive right now of what the other games are doing and how they can add that to their game. Do you have a question?
I put some information and I've seen some models of actual vehicles, new vehicles to be introduced in the game.
Okay.
What can you tell me about, for instance, the Katyusha, the Sturm Tiger, Object 777?
The Katyusha, that's the one with the rockets, yeah?
Yeah.
That was added in 2007, I think, as an April Fool's joke. So they had multiple rocket launchers put in as an April Fool's joke to say this is what we're going to add into to World of Tanks. For the Sturmtiger, they were thinking about putting in the Sturmtiger in game, but they couldn't decide whether they wanted it as artillery or TD. The thing was designed to level buildings and level side blocks. So it's something cool to be added to the game, but exactly where does it fit and how does it balance, basically, is how do you balance something like that? I mean, it fires a shell that's as tall as me and as wide as me. That's a big shell. So, you give it a huge reload or something, or just slow down its rotation speed, all this kind of stuff. So it's one of these vehicles where they would like to add it, but it's where it goes and how balanced is it realistically. So it's something that might never see the light of day. It's something that's there to be used, but it doesn't necessarily fit in the game model. If we ever have like a, you know, wipe out Himmelsdorf, then probably you would have a Sturmtiger as your vehicle. But the problem is with a lot of vehicles that you might find in super test files or in game files, they're just added in to get just a summary of let's test this, see what it is. But they don't have any plans to add it, not necessarily even for the next month. They might not even be thinking about adding it for the next year to half year or something like that. But they just want to gather initial stats. I mean, the MTLS is a prime example. Every time we go to the Netherlands, everyone's like, MTLS, where's the MTLS? It's been in the game files for at least 4 years, and it's still never been released in game in any region. Nobody has it on their server. Wargaming employees don't have it. Nobody. It's a tank that just, it's in the game files. When you play a demo account or a press account, it's on the demo and press accounts, but it doesn't exist in game, and I don't know what the plans with it ever will be.
Same with the Object 777?
Is that the one with the like raised up double tracks? I can't remember. I think they said that the initial plans with that one would be too hard to penetrate or something like that. I think the armor on it makes it too ridiculous to try and penetrate. But it's something that players have asked for a lot as well. But I think the last answer specifically to that vehicle is there's no plans to add it in. But that's the problem with future content is the developers say that now, and I'll go back to the office, and then there'll be an internal memo saying, hey guys, we're thinking about putting Object 77 in it. And I'm like, I just told everyone. So future content is really hard to comment on, because the developers will speak their mind on their personal blogs or on the Russian forums or from an unconfirmed source, because a lot of players said, a dev said, and they never ever show the source of where the dev said this. So they'll say, Storm said this, or from Unipatch log, and you know, or Richard said this, or Challenger, and there's never any source. So a lot of the time, you could just be reading what somebody wants you to read, or you could be just snapping at Wargaming because somebody wants you to snap at Wargaming for something that has never been said. So the way I always try and get players to get in the mind frame of is, until we announce it on our portal as coming in a patch, take everything with a pinch of salt, because everything's completely subject to change. Generally, it will never change when it's added into patch notes, because that means everything's signed off and confirmed. But any speculation before then, it could change completely, because who who knows who could have a say in it, you know, like we could be like, oh, we're going to add this tank. They'd be like, actually, we just did a focus group in this country and it's very, very bad because it has really bad memories of that tank doing something horrific to somebody and we can't add it. So just a random example or something like that. Like the Rising Sun flag, like the Koreans don't want.
Okay.
And it's the actual flag of the Japanese Navy, but we've removed it from the game, which is...
Actually, it was a big guessing about 777 after the contest of the IS-5. We in the clan were guessing that when the fall comes and we're now collecting the crowns and it's gonna be other new tank.
Yeah, well they always want to add unique and individual tanks for clan wars because they only want those tanks to be available for clan wars as a lure for people to get into clan wars. So people say it's unfair, I want this tank but I don't want to play clan wars. It's like, well,
yeah.
I'm sorry, but that's the whole point. If you want something, you have to participate in it to get the reward. The vehicle itself is an incentive. If we didn't have the vehicle as a reward and we just sold it, then there's no incentive for people to play clan wars. So that's the reasoning why these unique vehicles are only available in something like clan wars, is to try and get more people into clan wars and get them involved.
Okay.
Won't you try probably to add these reward tanks in the personal missions? Maybe.
Well, there's possibly that as well. I mean, I have the information on the USB stick, but we're not able to do a presentation. But at Tank Fest, we did a presentation about all the recent things we've added into the game as special features. So we talked about the football game mode and how many people participated in it. The Chaffee Races, for example. Chaffee Races was... I thought the football mode was more fun than Chaffee Races, personally. But Chaffee Races had something like 3 times the number of battles played compared to the football mode. So that was crazy, and they love the numbers from that, because then we can say, put this back in game, please. It was really fun,
yeah.
Players enjoyed it.
Yeah, yeah.
And they can't argue it, because we can go look at the statistics of the amount of people that played it, look how much fun they had, look at the funny videos of all the glitches of tanks getting blown across the battlefield. Like, don't change that, please keep that stuff in the game. Like, we don't mind, we think it's funny having that stuff, but some people are like, oh no, people are going to see our game's full of bugs. I'm like, it's a fun mod, who cares, you know?
8-bit tanks,
yeah.
They are very...
So these things are good things we can add in. With the what you said there about the individual missions,
yeah.
The amount of people that have the top tier tank,
is very small.
It's tiny. it's like less than 200 or something like
yeah.
that.
Seriously?
Yeah, it's really, really small, the number. So that's one of these things where, like, maybe we made we can go back and say, you made the personal missions too difficult. We're like, no, we haven't.
Okay.
Like, but we'll look at all the people who have the tank, tiny amount of players have the tank, so... And maybe tone it down and stuff like that. So,
but maybe put something else, like maybe the top tank would be something else, or you can have a choice.
Yeah, that's again, it's an alternative. We can
because
do stuff
maybe
like
people
that,
don't
yeah.
like the 260.
Yeah, well,
they don't play for it.
That's why we did that with Clan Wars. We gave people the choice of the different tanks. So maybe, I mean, the personal missions is again something else they're keen to tap into, because a lot of players now will look at the weekend specials and compare them to how weekend specials were 2 years ago. But 2 years ago you didn't have personal missions, you didn't have all these other things where you could get increased credits from, and that's where the weekend specials, they were, that was the main income for people to get additional credits. But now people have all these individual things they can do on their own, they don't have to wait till the weekend. So again, I think personal missions is something they kind of want to push more, and there's the reserves is something I've not totally got fully in my head around yet. But the reserves is another thing that is tailor-made to individual players to give them more income or bonuses and stuff.
How long is going to still be kept, those personal missions?
As far as I know, personal missions are in-game for forever you have, up until they decide to end the game for them to be removed. So it's not like we have to do the personal missions in like before September. The personal missions will be there this time next year unless there's any major changes.
Okay.
So players have their own time basically to work through them. Yes.
Do you know if they will be able to make the personal missions cater to people in clans as well? I have a clan of 60 people, and roughly 50 of those, including myself, stopped all clan activities and just went for the personal missions instead, actually.
I don't know. I mean, if it's interfering in clan wars, then they'll probably change it because they want people to play clan wars.
Primarily team battles.
Okay.
Yeah.
I don't know.
I don't know if they're aware of that.
They were trying to...
That's
something I can ask them to look into when we get back.
Nice.
Like, has there been a noticeable impact in like team battles or other kind of battles now with personal missions? Because they're keen to keep those things as an alternative. Because in the first group, a big topic, like the first part or the first half, if you like, of the first group was talking about matchmaker and matchmaker balance. And I'm saying how we have the random battles where you join in, you get random team members, random vehicles, random maps. And something we'd always potentially add would be a competitive queue system as well, separate from the random battle. So it's not like you separate, you click random battle and you go into a rank structure. It would be a separate rank structure, again, harking back to League of Legends, how they do it. You've got random battles there, and you've got a structured system based on your individual rankings. So that's something, again, that is more tailor-made to group-based stuff. But I'll certainly, when we go back, and say, you know,
it's kind of computing, right?
Yeah, yeah. We don't want them to compete. We want to give players more options, but keep them interested, basically.
Exactly.
Questions over here, yeah?
Yeah. I have one question. You were talking about Clan Wars. There are some territories in the new portal that says tier 6 to 10. So how does that work? I mean, if there's a clan that takes a territory as a tier 6 clan, and a tier 10 clan would attack, what would happen?
As I understand, I think they can only then attack with tier 6. They can't just then go in with tier 10. That was asked, and the question beforehand, the player, I think a man said that he previously you'd go in with your tier 6, and the guys would just come in at tier 6 and be like, yo, you know, like, you can't do
no,
that.
No, but...
Yeah, but I think it's changed now so that they would have to use tier 6s. The honest answer for me there is I don't know the answer to it. That would be a question I would ask the Clan Wars guy, and he would have the answer straight away, so...
Yeah, because if, say, the tier 10 clan doesn't have a full regiment of tier 6, there are... Well,
yeah, I'm not.
I honestly
don't know the mechanics. I don't want to try and wing.
Okay. I was just wondering.
Yeah.
Yeah, I recently started playing World of Warships and found the leveling system, the learning curve, was amazing.
Okay.
Because you start basic, you have your ship and the battle button, that's it. And slowly, as you progress through the game, you get more and more options, like consumables and so on. Are you thinking about putting that in the World of Tanks? I mean, you have the tutorial right now, but to be honest, that's...
Yeah, tutorials is something for a long time that we've been pushing for, but trying to make sure there's a balanced system. So for example, on Blitz and Xbox, if you start off as a new player, there's a tutorial. But many players don't do the tutorial because they find it boring and it's too long. So they skip the tutorial and you go into game, and then they complain because they don't know how to shoot people or where to shoot them.
Yeah, but it's not the part, but it's the leveling system.
Yeah,
slowly,
yeah.
Right now when you start World of Tanks, as somebody who doesn't know anything, you get in and you have a million options to do anything.
Yeah.
But
so
in Warships, you just have the battle button, slowly get
to
learn.
With that, Warships was built from the ground up with that in place. So from the ground up, they thought to themselves, we need some kind of new player protection, and we want to have a bot system. We want to have a AI system that you fight against. So they had that in from the very start, and tanks can't have that because of the way the maps are. So you have a bot, and Warships is very much a simplified version of a tank bot, because you don't have the aiming circles, you don't have the angling, and you don't have maps of varying terrains. And I mean, there's so many places you can get stuck in a World of Tanks map. The bots in Warships used to be really dumb. They used to sail into each other. They used to sail into islands every time, and they had like laser accurate guns. So you would laugh at them being stuck in an island all the time while they were destroying you. And they wanted to put in a system that helped players learn their ships from the start, but not, I mean, another thing that we're trying to push for is to learn the different classes. So teach carrier players how to play carriers, as much as people maybe don't want people to know how to play carriers. Teach destroyer players how to ambush battleships and how to use the smoke and be effective at destroyers. Teach cruiser players the benefit of protecting your carrier or protecting your battleships and engaging the destroyers. Like, ways to teach people how to do stuff. And another aspect of that is we then rely on the community to help us with that. So we then have our community contributors who do instructional videos on how to do different things. And sometimes they're much better explaining things than we could explain things to players. Because we see it as very basic. How can they not understand this? This is the way we want people to play the game. But people might play the game differently. So going back to like the things I've mentioned before, if it shows as being a really good system in tank and Warships, then it's potential to be moved into tanks as well, and the similar system is very high, because we can say, well, look how effective it is in this game, let's put it in this game as well. So it's another one of these ones, because Warship's brand new, and because we're in our second week of open beta, we need to let it go through a certain bedding in period before then we can then hit the World of Tanks guys with a load of things saying, look how good this is. One of the benefits we now have for World of Warships is that our producer European producer is now the global publishing producer for Warships. So that's somebody from, if you like, our side that can like lean on people a bit and then, you know, put the European voice through our player base voice through.
Okay.
But it's, I mean, I totally understand you come from, like, you start off, you don't have captains, then you unlock the captain, you don't
exactly.
have the flags, then you unlock
you
the
flags.
You
have a steady learning curve,
yeah.
And you're
and
not confused.
At the start, you have to play against bots, you don't play against players, and if you want, you're not then forced to play against players, you can go, actually, no, I'd rather want to keep playing as the bots. Mm. And even then, at any time, when you unlock a new ship, you could then just go into co-op battle against bots and learn the new mechanics of the ship and how to play it, because
yeah.
not every ship plays the same when you go up through the tiers.
Okay.
Any more questions on this side? Because I've been quite heavy on this side. Yes?
Sort of. Have you considered making some kind of offline mode for World of Tanks so you can test out the new tanks?
Possibly. I mean, the devs want the test server to be the thing where people can go in and test tanks.
The danger
of having offline play in games like our games is that it then opens the clients up to manipulation by people.
Yeah.
So if you have an online system and it's all server-based calculations, it's less chance of it being abused by people than if you had something where it's offline. An example of thinking about that I could give would be, I used to play Halo all the time, Halo 2 on Xbox, and you used to be able to get map packs downloaded, and when you downloaded the map pack, it was downloaded and saved onto your console. And whenever you had people speed hacking in game, it was always on those downloaded maps because it was something that was applied to what was downloaded on the console, and it never happened on the other maps that were part of the pool that you would get from the server of the game. So that danger, if we had stuff where people could do stuff offline, it could be easy to be manipulated and not recorded necessarily from us. So a bot's potentially a bot system where you fight against bots. People might argue it's in game already where you fight against bots. it's always a potential to look at to give people additional training methods or training systems or ways to learn new vehicles as well. Usually when you, I think it's when you unlock a vehicle, I'm pretty sure it's still in place, when you unlock a vehicle for the first time, your first 10 matches, you're usually never at the bottom of the tier. You're given 10 matches bedding in period of that vehicle, where I think you're either top or middle, so you're never more than you're never going to be bottom tier and have somebody two tiers higher than you. You're going to have people just one tier higher than you, or you're going to be top tier, but you're in the stock tank usually for 10 battles. Then after that, you're subject to full normal matchmaking. That's one of the only times matchmaking is adjusted for players, basically, when you unlock a new vehicle. And you can kind of use that to your advantage if you have free XP, because you unlock a vehicle, use your free XP to full upgrade it, and you know your next ten battles are usually going to be good battles. Yes?
Are there coming any more ships of the same class and tier in the same countries?
For countries as it is just now,
World of Warships.
Yeah, for countries as it is just now in Warships, the tiers are not necessarily locked in. So ships that are where they are now in certain tiers could still be moved. So a prime example is the Cleveland. There's a high chance the Cleveland's not going to stay at tier 6, because the Cleveland at tier 6 is actually nerfed quite heavily to get it to fit into tier 6. So there's a high chance the Cleveland could move to a second American cruiser line, where it would probably be something like tier 8. And it's the same for other ships as well. Certain ships are kind of shoehorned to fit into a certain tier. But there may be, because that nation has a wider pool, I mean, you're not going to get, like, it's very unlikely you're going to get two Russian cruiser lines and two Russian battleship lines, you know. But for the British ships, for example, the British mantra was cruisers. They weren't focused on the big guns all the time. They wanted light, fast ships. So they might have two cruiser lines before everyone else. Same with the Americans. German battleships and cruisers might have more, like, ones where you go down, like, half the trees one, like, half the trees cruiser, and then the back half the trees then battleship or something like that. So they could be added in the same way that it works with World of Tanks. It really just depends on what assets we have from those nations and how common the ships were, basically. But there's a huge potential, I think, for Americans and British trees to be more expansive than other nations. I mean, you're never going to get two Russian carrier lines. I think we're struggling to get one Russian carrier line. Same with the Germans as well. But a lot of them can be used as, like, well, they had a battleship, so a lot of battleships in World War II were converted into carriers or had a carrier version, so it's very easy for them to make that changeover or addition to the tree. Okay, so it's about 1:30. is there any more questions, or I think we can maybe start making a move to go over to the Maritime Museum?
A slightly silly one. Are there anyone in your office that doesn't have a beard?
Yes. Dennis, who's walking about here, Dennis doesn't have it. He has something, but there's quite a few people actually. The problem is now is that people get me and Arnaud mixed up at distance. So they think that I'm Arnaud or they think that he's me. I've always been at Wargaming with a beard. At the start it wasn't very bushy, it was just like quite trimmed. Before I came to Wargaming though, I never used to have a beard. I shaved it off twice at Wargaming. The first time I actually walked all the way into the office and had three people ask who I was. Even walking past my manager, who shouted me back into the office and asked me what I was doing, because he didn't recognise me. So everyone in Wargaming has always known me with a beard, they've never known me without a beard. I trimmed it earlier on in the year, I trimmed it in too short and I hated it, so now I'm just letting it grow again. So. It's good, but sometimes it's really nice, especially if you wake up late in the morning and you're like, oh, I don't have time to shower, I've got to get out the door, I've got to rush out the door. You've maybe been sleeping the entire night on the side of your beard, and you don't realise that it's all in close to one side of your face or it's all the way out and stuff. So it's a blessing and a curse. The worst is when you're eating and it comes in from the moustache and shower. It takes a bit of getting used to it. Last question.
A question about Tankfest next year.
Okay.
Are you also going to be the main contributor next year?
Yes. Basically, unless anything changes, we want to have a much bigger partnership with... not much bigger partnership. We already have a really amazing relationship with Bovington. We partner a lot on stuff. We have the education centre. Victor's a massive fan. He always makes sure to come over every year, even if it's just for one day. I think this year he was only there for like half of the day, but he definitely made it a point to come across the Tankfest. We have, contrary to what you might read on the internet, we have like an absolutely fantastic relationship with him. We sponsored Tankfest this year, and we assisted the European community contributors to come over to Tankfest. And we want to make it something that becomes like a player mecca, if you like, for World of Tanks. So like it's like almost like a BlizzCon in a way for like World of Tanks. If you're a World of Tanks fan, if you're a tank fanatic, then come to Tankfest. You're going to be able to see all the vehicles driving about. You're going to have the Wargaming staff there. You're going to have Wargaming community contributors, like internet people, like celebrities, if you want to call them that, or whatever. So we want these people to be there and people to meet them and people to have fun and make it like a memorable event. And to have, you know, Wargaming World of Tanks linked into it as well. So we're always, every year, we always exceed expectations. So we're like, okay, we'll do this year. And it happens, like, oh crap. Like this year, we didn't expect so many people to queue up for the game. This is actually the fifth year we were at World of Tanks at Bovington. Some people tell you it's the fourth year, it's not. We were there the first year. We had, nine PCs. We had Overlord, and we had two girls in skimpy outfits. So the very first year it was totally Russian. It was very, very like how Wargaming was at the start in World of Tanks. It was like, oh, look at the sexy girls in skimpy outfits, come play tanks, you know? It was not the way we kind of want tanks to be now, you know? So that was like that for the first year. For the second year we had 12 PCs and we had two girls that were in just more military uniform. We still had girls, very attractive girls, but they weren't wearing skimpy outfits anymore. That year was really funny because we gave out white t-shirts that said tanks ready, skies coming soon, or skies loading and then ships coming soon, or something like really old, or air, it was like land ready, air coming soon or whatever. And those were the t-shirts the staff had, and we didn't have name badges, but those were our t-shirts, you could identify the Wargaming staff. But those were the t-shirts we're also handing out to everybody. so many people go to Tankfest for 2 days. So on the second day, you went from having three or four booth staff on the first day, to the second day you had like 25 booth staff because everyone's walking around in these t-shirts. So that was another learning curve. And we didn't do time management on the stage either. So just sit down, play, whatever. The third year, we had a bigger space, more computers. And we had, I think, some Xbox consoles to show off the Xbox as well, and it was just World of Tanks again. And that was where we had the issue with, I don't know if any of you know, Mighty Jingles. Jingles went to the booth. I know Jingles really well, but that year I wasn't at Tank Fest. So Jingles had a German tank driver uniform on, which somebody somebody accused him of being an SS uniform. So it did have the, it had the Balkan cruiser or whatever, the symbol, but it didn't have the SS symbol. So he was asked to, I mean, most reenactors will use like black tape to cover over the SS symbols or something like that, like they're a bit smart. So he was asked to take his jacket off, he refused to do it. Staff in our booth at the time were being stubborn, so they wouldn't change their ways, and there was a little bit of a PR nightmare. We got over that though, everything's fine now. The year after, we had the truck, but the booth management system wasn't there, so the truck was parked in the middle of the hall with no queuing system, so that was a nightmare trying to get people through the booth. And then this year we had a queue system, but the queue system was usually 2 hours long for the entire weekend. So, and that was having people only play for 10 minutes at a time to get a goodie bag. So more PCs is what we need in a bigger space, because to me it's always surprising how many people want to play the game. And so a lot of it is people who play the game already and they still want to come and play because maybe they want to play a tank they've never played before that's on their account. But going forward, next year Tank Fest is going to have another big huge focus, and we've got bigger and bolder plans for it for next year as well. So I think definitely we're going to be there for next year.
And more jingles.
Yeah, we should just wrap up a bit more. So, what we'll do is we'll head over onto the Maritime Museum now, where we can get some drink. Thanks everyone for your attention.